We're going to take you back to the 80s. Make some noise, y'all. Come on, put your hands together. Make some noise, hey. Hey. Come on, let's encourage right here.
Don't wait till the battle is over. Shout now.
Yeah.
You know in the end, you're going to win.
What y'all going to say?
Don't wait till the battle is over. Shout now.
Yeah.
You know in the end, you're going to win.
Say it one more time, y'all. Hey.
Don't wait till the battle is over. Shout now.
Yeah.
You know in the end, you're going to win.
Come on, tell somebody. One more time, say.
Don't wait till the battle is over.
Chicago's own Miss Kim McFarlane.
Good morning. This is the day that the Lord has made. We rejoice and are glad in it. We welcome you to our worship service today. We thank God that you have come to worship with us. God has been so good. He is so awesome, and He is worthy of our praise. From the rising of the sun to the going down of the same, our hearts are filled with praise. Our lips are filled with praise. We invite you to come and worship God with us. Sing the songs with us. Pray the prayers with us. Read the scriptures with us. We don't want you to just witness the service. We want you to be blessed by the service and to be a part of the service. So we invite you to come and worship with us today. Now, just a little housekeeping. I hope you won't forget. please touch the thumbs up button and like our video. Please share this video with as many people as you can. And thirdly and finally, if you are not subscribed to our channel, we hope that you will subscribe to our channel today. Well, we've got the housekeeping out of the way. Come, let's worship the Lord. Make a joyful noise unto the Lord, all ye lands. Serve the Lord with gladness. Come before his presence with singing. Know ye that the Lord, he is God. It is he who has made us, and not we ourselves. We are his people, and the sheep of his pasture. Enter into his gates with thanksgiving and into his courts with praise. Be thankful unto him and bless his name. For the Lord is good. His mercy is everlasting. And his truth endures to all generations.
Come on and put your hands together, everybody. We're gonna bless the name of the Lord.
Oh, yeah.
Hey, he's worthy. We're gonna lift him up this morning, yeah.
Bless the Lord, oh my soul. Bless the Lord, oh my soul. And all that is within me, bless his holy name. Say, bless the Lord.
call your name, Jesus.
Yes, Lord.
Hallelujah. We believe that you are our healer.
Jesus.
We believe that you are our provider, our protector. We've seen you do these things for us. Hallelujah. So that's what we call you. You are all of that. And we worship your name and we magnify you, God. Hallelujah. And we'll keep calling you over and over and over and over and over and over. Hallelujah. Call the name of Jesus. He is our healer. Call the name of Jesus. He is our protector. Yeah. Call the name of Jesus. He is our provider. Call the name of Jesus. He is our deliverer. Yeah. Whoa.
Yeah.
to call you, Jesus. Woo. And we love to call you. Join with me right there. Say, we love to call you
Jesus.
Hey, King of Kings, we love to call
Jesus.
You're our master, say Jesus. You're our protector.
Jesus.
Yeah, we love to call you
Jesus.
Yeah,
Jesus.
Come on, call him right there.
Jesus.
Call him in your home. Say, we love to call him. Call him right now. One more time, say, oh, King Jesus, another name, King Jesus, none stronger. When we call on your hey, things changes. When we call on your name, sing that with me, say,
King Jesus.
God says, bring ye all the tithes into the storehouse, that there might be meat, that there might be provision in God's house. And prove me now herewith, saith the Lord of hosts, and see if I will not open for you the windows of heaven and pour out a blessing you shall not have room enough to receive. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for continuing to provide me everything I need to give you my tithes and offerings, to pay every bill I have, to pay every person I owe, and to be generous and help those in need. In the name of Him who is rich unto every blessing, even Christ Jesus our Lord, we pray, amen. Now I want to say to our Calvary family, please be faithful during these difficult times of sheltering in. Yes, the churches are closed, but all of our churches, including Calvary, continue to have financial obligations, bills, if you will, that have to be paid every month. And so we're asking you to please be faithful in the giving of your tithes and of your offerings. For those of you who have an offering envelope at home, it is already pre-addressed. You have but to put your offering and tithe in it, put your stamp on it, and mail it. For others of us, we will be using electronic mediums. So whether it's the Cash App or Givelify or EasyTithe, we want to make it easy for you to be a blessing to the kingdom of God and to support the church in these very, very difficult times. As you might suspect,
our church, as many, many churches today, have suffered a financial deficit because of the coronavirus and because of the shelter-in-place rules. We understand that. So we're asking our Calvary family, please, please be diligent and faithful in your giving. To those of you who may not be members of Calvary, we thank you so much for your support. We thank you for joining in with us. And we would also love to have your financial support. You too can go to our website and click on the giving tab, or you can text to give through EasyTithe, or you can use Givelify or Cash App. But we pray that you will support our church financially through these difficult, difficult times. Thank you so much. God bless you. Indeed, there is no name greater or higher than the name Jesus Christ. We thank God for that wonderful name. If you will, today I would like to call your attention to a passage of scripture found in the 18th chapter of the Gospel according to Luke. I shall read verses 1 through 8 from the New International Version. Then Jesus told his disciples a parable to show them that they should always pray and not give up. He said, "In a certain town there was a judge who neither feared God nor cared about men. And there was a widow in that town who kept coming to him with the plea, 'Grant me justice against my adversary.' For some time he refused, but finally he said to himself, 'Even though I don't fear God or care about men, yet because this widow keeps bothering me, I will see that she gets justice so that she won't eventually wear me out with her coming.' And the Lord said, 'Listen to what the unjust judge says. And will not God bring about justice for his chosen ones who cry out to him day and night? Will he keep putting them off? I tell you, he will see that they get justice and quickly. However, when the Son of Man comes, will he find faith on the earth?'" Here ends the reading. I would like to use as a topic today, "This is the moment. Keep on bothering them." This is a pivotal moment in the history of these United States. It is a pivotal moment in the history of African Americans, the first 20 of whom came to these American shores 401 years ago. It is a pivotal moment for the United States of America. It is a pivotal moment for African Americans. It is a pivotal moment for the entire world. For America still presents itself in the world public as the image and model of the possibility and the beauty of democracy. That image has been tarnished in the eyes of the whole world. And this is the moment to make a difference and to make a change. Unfortunately, in the history of our country, in the history of African Americans, Americans of African descent in this country, we have had many pivotal moments. And unfortunately, in times past, America has abysmally failed each moment. The first moment came in 1865, at the end of the Civil War. That was a time for our country to come together to decide what to do about its newly freed slaves, 4 million former slaves who had nothing, no money, no land, no education, no opportunity. I spoke to you some weeks past about Field Order 15, which was issued by a Union general, William Tecumseh Sherman, which granted 40 acres and a mule to 40,000 former slaves in Georgia, South Carolina, and Florida. But within the span of just 1 year, all of that land was confiscated from the former slaves, and that land was given to whites. This is a very pivotal moment where our country failed, because at that very time, not 40 acres and a mule, but 400 acres, 4,000 acres, 40,000 acres were being given away to settlers who moved into Western territories, land that America gave to immigrants and to others in this country, and yet did not understand that the African slaves should have the same right to such a land grant that would have enfranchised them and given them the opportunity to build farms and to build homes and to build families and to build wealth that could be passed on from generation to generation. It was not that this country didn't give out land and opportunity. It was just that this country refused to give it to its citizens of African descent. Ah, but there was a second pivotal moment. In the 10 years after the Civil War, roughly from 1865 to 1877, the period we called the Reconstruction, it was another pivotal opportunity. And initially, it gave political rights to former slaves. Rights that these slaves used to vote and elect to office congresspersons and senators in the United States Congress. But many Northern liberals had grown weary of the race question and weary of the problem of the former slaves. And so they lost nerve and they lost heart. Meanwhile, down in the South, the Ku Klux Klan was allowed to rampage and pillage, to murder and to rape and to lynch and to kill thousands of black people and to keep them from the polls from voting. And the time of Reconstruction became a time of destruction. When the Northern liberals had grown weary and lost nerve about the race question, and when the Ku Klux Klan was allowed to go on a rampage throughout the South, creating fear among black people, killing, raping, murdering, lynching, burning down their little shacks and shanties. And so that little brief period of about 12 years came to an ignominious end. And then there came another pivotal moment. The 50s and 60s of the 20th century, in the civil rights movement led by Dr. Martin Luther King Jr., roughly from 1956 to 1968. Oh, to be sure, there were some gains during this period. The 1954 decision about segregated education, the 1964 and 65 acts which went through Congress, the Civil Rights Act and the Voting Rights Act. In effect, we had brought about a change in American society. No longer did blacks have to go to the back of the bus or the back of the restaurant. Blacks could use public facilities. Yes, things had changed. Dr. King's movement had affected in part the civil rights of black people, but it had not brought about a change in the human rights, the right to life, the right to respect, the right to decency. Yes, it had not brought about human rights, and more importantly, it had not brought about economic rights. For without economic rights, then our civil rights and our political rights mean so little. Economic rights are important because economic rights provide empowerment and enfranchisement. These rights would give to all of the Americans of African descent an opportunity in this country that we have never had before. No, it is not. Reparations are not about a give out or a handout. No, we're not asking anyone to give us anything. We're simply asking for justice. We are simply asking for fairness. We're not asking you to give us a handout. No, we are demanding what is rightfully ours, what is owed to the people of African descent in this country for 400 years of free slave labor. Oh, yes, this is the moment, and it will not be assuaged by a few police reforms. Any one of us in America today can see that we need serious police reforms throughout the land. It will not be assuaged alone simply by making Juneteenth a national holiday. Yes, it is important. It is important that we have police reform and we have better police training. It is vital that we have dates like Juneteenth to remember and to celebrate. But without economic enfranchisement that would create wealth generation that can be passed on from one generation to another, then we will continue to have the kind of strife and unrest in our streets that America so rightly deserves. Yes, this is the moment to make the hard decisions and to make the decisions that America has failed to make for 400 years. This is the moment. Think about it. 1865 to 1877, the period of Reconstruction, 12 years. Think about it, from 1877 to 1954, then we're thinking now about 80 years. Think about the end of the civil rights movement, roughly 1965 until today, 55 years. What I'm saying to you, brothers and sisters, is that these pivotal moments, these crucial moments of change come along in 40, 50, 60, 70, 80 year spans. So we cannot let this moment pass. We must do what is right and we must do what is just and we must do it now. Nothing less than total reparations to Americans of African descent. Oh, to be sure, not only has America given thousands of acres to many other immigrants, but America has given reparations also. Reparations to Native Americans, reparations to Asian Americans, reparations to Jewish Americans. Then to be sure, the African Americans too deserve the reparations that we have so justly earned in this country. Well, I come to our text. I come to our text about a little woman who is after justice. She is a widow and she is seeking justice. Oh, it makes me remember one of my favorite movies. Perhaps some of you who are younger will not remember or you haven't seen this movie. But if you haven't, I encourage you to look it up. Look it up on your video on demand or your Netflix or whatever movie venue you have. But it was a movie entitled The Verdict, and it starred Paul Newman. It was about a young lady who had become a vegetable in the hospital, not due to any sickness of her own, but due to medical malpractice. Somehow, this bummed out lawyer, who is now an alcoholic and who has failed, ends up with this case in his lap. He is operating on behalf of the family of this woman who has become a vegetable. And they are pursuing this case because they say that her sickness is due to medical malpractice. Well, the hospital was a Catholic hospital. And so the Catholic Church hired this juggernaut team of attorneys to defend it against this poor little family. This juggernaut legal team, it has simply destroyed Paul Newman's case, destroyed his prime witness. And it was literally nothing on the law books that said Paul Newman would win this case. Yes, this juggernaut legal team had simply bulldozed this little old independent, washed out, alcoholic lawyer. But he had one moment to speak to the jury. And I don't remember his exact words. When you watch the movie, you will see it. But he said something to this effect. If you want justice, then you simply have to act justly. He said, if you want justice, it's not out there somewhere. Justice is in you. And if justice is in you, then you can act justly. Oh, here is this woman in our text. She has been wronged by her adversary, and she is now seeking justice. She is seeking what is fair. She is seeking what is right. She has three strikes against her. Number one, she is a woman. And in her day, women did not go to court. But not only is she a woman, she has a second strike against her, which is she is a woman who is a widow. And since women cannot go to court, and since her husband is dead, she doesn't have a husband who can go to court on her behalf to plead her cause. But thirdly and finally, she is a poor widow, and therefore she has no money. You have to kind of understand how the system of jurisprudence worked in that day. Yes, in that day, the judge decided which case he would hear or not hear. And so the cases that came before him were the cases where people had enough money to pay him, to grease his palm, to pay his attendants, to have the right to stand before his bench and have their cases to be heard. No, she was a woman. She shouldn't be in court. She was a widow. She had no one to stand on her behalf. And she was poor. She could not grease the judge's palm. She could not grease his attendants' palms. She could not pay to have her case heard before the judge. But if you want justice, then first of all, you must act justly, for justice is in you. This woman had justice in her. Well, I want to say two things about her and about justice, and I'm finished. Yes, now is the moment for justice. Not just a few penny ante reforms, not just a Juneteenth celebration, not just a police reform, but let us seriously and truly deal with the real issues of racism and white supremacy in this country. Well, first of all, we see the opportunity for justice. We see the opportunity for justice. Think about it. She takes the opportunity to seek justice. Why? Because she has been treated unjustly. Jesus does not tell us in the parable what injustice has been done to her. Perhaps by the system, was it systemic racism about which she was seeking justice? Or perhaps was it some police brutality? Had her son been beaten by some racist cop? Or perhaps was it a neighbor or a business person who had done her wrong? Or perhaps was it some boss in corporate America who had looked over her because of her gender, because of her sex, her gender? Or was it because maybe not racism or sexism, but maybe it was the job she deserved, but because of favoritism or nepotism, someone else was given the job? Or maybe it was an injustice done to her in her own home, in her own family, or by some dear friend. Jesus does not tell us what the injustice was. It does not matter, because what? He is talking about all injustice, all in our interpersonal relationships, in our social relationships, in our systems and institutions. He is talking about any injustice and every injustice. And this woman sees an opportunity for justice, for any injustice brings with it the opportunity for justice. Oh, today is the moment. Don't miss this moment. We must seek justice in every way and in every form in our lives and in our society. We must seek justice. Justice at City Hall. We must seek justice. Justice in the courtrooms in America, all the way to the Supreme Court. We must seek justice. Justice in the state houses. Yes, all over America. Justice in the houses of Congress. Justice in the White House. Yes, we must seek justice, for every injustice is an opportunity for justice. Yes, we must seek justice even in the streets as we march with Black Lives Matter. Yes, even in the streets, we must seek justice at every turn, in every way. It's not one thing that's going to solve this problem, but many things it will take at every level of our lives and at every level of this society. Four times in these eight verses, we see the word justice. And one time, yes, the judge who represents God, who is like a God figure, says, I must give her justice. And then finally, in his explanation of the meaning of the parable, Jesus said, don't you know that your God, he loves you more than any judge, and that if you are his chosen one, or if you are his children, you are his people, then don't you know that our God will bring justice and bring it quickly for you? you. Oh, my brothers and sisters, do not turn your head away from injustice. Remember that every injustice is an opportunity for you to seek justice. It is an opportunity for all of us to seek justice. Yes, we have no right to expect justice if we are not willing at every level, at every dimension to fight for justice and to seek justice. Oh, this is so important because God says that when his people pray, when his people call on him night and day, that he will give us justice. Let us pray for justice, but let us fight for justice and work for justice. Yes, every injustice is an opportunity for justice. We see the opportunity for justice. But secondly and finally, we see the importunity for justice. It's very interesting. You must understand this text, this parable, in its context. For in the time about which Jesus spoke, the judge did not sit in some palatial building where people would come and the cases would be heard by the judge. No, back in those days, the judge operated out of a little tent, and that tent was on a circuit. He would move from a little town to a little village, one day here, one day there. And so he would move all over from place to place to hear the cases that people would pay to come and bring before him. This woman, she had justice within her, and she was determined that she would not stop. She was determined that she would not turn back. Yes, she was a woman. Yes, she was a widow. Yes, she was poor, but she kept crying out. And every day when he set up his tent in a new village, she'd follow him to that village. And when he'd go to the next village, she'd follow him to that village. And when he went to the town, she'd follow him to that town. And she'd keep on crying out, "Mr. Judge, Mr. Judge, I seek justice." Let me tell you something, brothers and sisters. Justice is not something that's just in the air. Justice is in you and me, and you and I. We must fight for justice. It is something for which we must fight. It is something for which we must demand. We demand justice. We fight for justice. Yes, yes, we must do it with importunity. You know what? So many people in our police precincts, so many people in state houses around America, so many people in the White House, so many people even in the halls of Congress, they are just sitting back, folding their arms, waiting for us to get tired. Tired of marching in the streets. Tired of making speeches. Tired of our prayer meetings. They're just waiting for us to get tired. Get tired, tired, to lose hope, to lose nerve, to give up, to go on back to our jobs and our workplaces and our regular lives. They're just waiting us out. But I'm telling you today that if you want justice, and if we want the American society to be a society of justice, it's not in the air, it's in us, the people, and we must continue to fight for it. Walk together, children, and don't you get weary. Walk together, children, and don't you get tired. Be not weary in well-doing, for in due season we shall reap if we faint not. No, justice doesn't just fall down from the skies. We work for justice. We fight for justice. We pray for justice. The justice is in us. And if we will fight for that justice, we can have justice in our society, and we can have justice in our world. The judge says, "Man, I don't fear God. I don't care about what people think." All he cared about was moving from town to town and people greasing his hand with money. That's all he cared about. He said, but you know, if I don't give this woman justice, she's an embarrassment. She keeps showing up everywhere I go. I go to one town, she's there. I go to the next town, she gets louder. You know what? Let me just hear her case and give her justice, and let me just get rid of this woman, because she keeps on bothering me. That's what I've come by to tell you, that this is the moment. Keep on bothering them. This is the moment that we must not get weak and weary or lose hope. This is the moment for us to keep on bothering them. Bother them until justice rolls down like waters and righteousness, like an ever-flowing stream. Bother them until we begin to end the injustice, the racial injustice in this country. Yes, this is the moment to bother them until we right the wrongs of 400 years of dehumanization and exploitation of black people in America. Yes, this is the moment. It may not come back for another 100 years, but right now, while the iron is hot, we must strike, we must fight, we must pray, we must march. Yes, we must meet, we must demand. Now is the time to keep on bothering them. Now is the time for the lion to lie down with the lamb. Now is the time to have fairness and equity. Yes, all over this land. Now is the time. Yes, and we will not do it unless we keep on bothering them. The true patriots. The true patriots in America, the people who really love this country, are not the people who say, ah, America, love it or leave it. It's not the people who say, well, we may not be perfect, but we are better than any other country on the face of the earth. Those are not the people who love America. The people who love America are the people who keep on bothering America. The judge says, this woman, if I don't give her justice, she just keeps on bothering me. Be a person that just keeps on bothering injustice. We'll fight for it. We'll march for it. We'll pray for it. We'll join hands for it. We'll meet in the courthouses, at the White House, in the houses of Congress, in the state houses, at City Hall, in our neighborhoods and our communities. Keep on bothering them. Keep on fighting against injustice and wrong and unfairness. And Jesus said, don't you know that if that old wicked judge would finally hear that little widow, that little nobody, don't you know that if you keep on bothering them, don't you know if you keep on bothering God, that your Father who loves you will give you justice, and he will give it to us quickly. Oh yes, we're gonna bother injustice, but this is the moment to bother God. We're gonna march, we're gonna fight, and we're also gonna pray. This is the moment to keep on bothering them until we rid this land of the ugly vesture of racism and bigotry. Justice is in you. Fight for it. This is the opportunity. Do you have the importunity to fight for it and to keep on fighting and to keep on praying? Justice is in you. God bless you.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Jesus, we are free. I'm free indeed. No chains are holding me. It's who I choose to be. Yeah, I'm free indeed. In Christ, I'm free indeed. No chains are holding me. It's who I choose to be. Say free, yeah.
Today, I would like to present to you the opportunity to know Jesus Christ If you are listening today and you don't have a personal relationship with God, the only way to have a personal relationship with God is through Jesus Christ. He says, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except by me. The way to God the Father is through his Son, Jesus Christ. And Jesus only requires that you receive him, that you believe him, that you accept him, that you believe that he is the Son of God, and that when he died at a place called Calvary, he died as a sacrifice for your sins and mine. John put it like this: he came unto his own, and his own received him not, but to as many as did receive him, to as many as did believe in him, to as many as did trust him, to them he gave the right to become children of God. You must believe, receive, that he is the Son of God, that he died for your sins. And God did not leave him in the grave, but he raised him from the grave to demonstrate his power over death, hell, and the grave. And today, he wants to be your Lord and your Savior. Today, he wants to come into your heart and live inside of you. Jesus Christ comes into our lives by invitation. He's not the big bad wolf who says, I'll huff and I'll puff and I'll blow your house down. He is the gentle Lamb of God who says, behold, I stand at the door and knock. If anyone will hear my voice and open the door, I will come in. I will live inside of you. I will forgive you of your sins. I will write your name in the Lamb's book of life if you'll open that door. You open the door simply by praying a little prayer of invitation. I'm going to pray that prayer right now. And if today you have never before accepted Jesus Christ as your Savior and Lord, if today you want Jesus Christ to live in your life, then I'm going to ask you to simply repeat this little prayer after me. Repeat it with your mouth and in your heart. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for sending Jesus to die on the cross for my sins. I open my heart to you, Lord Jesus, and I ask you to come into my life. Forgive me of my sins and live inside of me. I want to be your child and I want to live eternally with you in your kingdom. Thank you for what you did for me at Calvary. Thank you for what you're doing in me right now. And thank you for what you are going to do through me by the power of your Holy Spirit. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. The Bible says, whoever calls upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. And if you prayed that prayer today, then you called upon the name of the Lord. God promises you salvation and eternal life. If you prayed that prayer today, please email us at info@cbcjny.org. And simply email us your name and your cell number, and we will be in touch with you. Or if today you are watching this video and you're not a member of a church, by the miracle of modern technology, we invite you to join our church fellowship. And if you would like to so do, email us your name and your number at info@cbcjny.org, and we will be in touch with you. Thank you for sharing this worship service with us today. May God bless you. We thank you for sharing these brief moments with us. Please hit the thumbs up button and like this video. Please share this video with as many people as you can. And if you have not subscribed to our channel, please do so. We thank you so, so much. Before I give the benediction, I want to have a word of prayer for you. Dear God, our Heavenly Father, how thankful that we can call you our Father and know that we are your children. I thank you for every person who will see this video, hear this video. I pray, dear Father, in the name of Jesus, that every person under the sound of my voice will have the peace with God and the peace of God. I pray that you will be their strength. I pray that you will be their light. I pray that you will be their joy. Cause them to know that each day in Jesus Christ is a day of victory. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. In Jesus' name, amen.
Come on, y'all. Let's give God our worship tonight. Come on, put your hands on it.
It's not like you.
Hey, into the darkness, hey, into
the
darkness. Out of the ashes, everybody say it. Come on, say it.
There's
hey, everybody, come on, raise it. Not like you.
There's no God like
you. You can search to the ear.
everybody lift it up. Is that God?